start with, who've set themselves a huge and rather unusual challenge, because they're going to cycle from the Orkney Islands all the way to the Scilly Isles, doing up to 100 miles a day. And you're thinking, there's a problem there. There's a flaw in that, because there'll be at least two bodies of sea to cross, won't there, to get from island to mainland to island. Yes, they've thought of that. They're going to use water bikes to cycle across the sea and normal bikes to cycle on the land. And I'm not sure I even know what a water bike is. So we need to chat to Isaac Kenyon and Ben Ajayiobi. Welcome back to the show, guys.
Hi, Bill.
Hi.
Morning. I have to say, as soon as I saw the names, I thought, oh, I know these two. I know what reason they'll be on, or at least the kind of reason they'll be on the show for, because you have form for this extreme kind of challenge. So, Isaac, just remind us what we were talking about last time you were on, first of all.
Last time we were on, I think, was a 3,000 nautical mile Atlantic row.
Yep.
To from La Gomera in the Canary Islands to Antigua in the Caribbean. And, yeah, we lived to... And I think we lived to tell the tale, and I think we told it on your show, perhaps.
You did. And I love the way you say, I think last time it was an Atlantic row, as if, you know, you do so many of these kinds of things. Was it that one, or was it that other thing we did, or that other thing we did?
That tends to be the case when it comes to me and Isaac.
Yeah, well, you as I say, you do have a track record for it. Let's talk then, Ben, about this time. Tell me first of all about sea bikes or water bikes, whatever you call them, because I'm not sure I could even picture one in my mind.
So the water bike, it's quite an unusual looking device, but I think if you were to see it, you would immediately understand what it is. The way I would describe it is, it's kind of like if you had a spin bike and you attached two flotation devices underneath it. And that spin bike is connected to a propeller underneath, so that propels you forward as you kind of float delicately on top of the surface of the water.
Right.
I think these bikes is quite a different scenario to a regular bike, as you can imagine. They're very vulnerable to the wind, as very little of the actual bike is under the water, so you can get blown all over the place. You have to make sure that you know the conditions are going to be right before you set off.
But you see, I would have thought that sea conditions often changed unexpectedly. So supposing you've set off on from the Orkneys to the Scottish mainland, and then the weather turns, couldn't that happen?
It could happen. I mean, the actual distance is only 10 to 15 miles, and
only.
We have support passing. Yeah, but when you're talking about that, it's probably about 2-3 hours on the water. Mm-hmm. So we will have like very good, you know, looking at the currents, the tides. We're going in a neap tide, which is the best time to go for good conditions. And we'll check the weather and make sure that the winds aren't that strong. And I think the first leg is less likely for weather conditions to really hinder it. The second leg is 26 miles from Land's End to the Isles of Scilly. That's where the weather can catch you out, and that's where, I guess, the question remains.
Right. Go on, Ben. Yes, carry on, Ben.
A lot of this is down to being able to predict that window of time that we know is going to give us that opening to make that journey. We're working with like people who've got so much experience predicting these kinds of things. So that should give us the best chance to make the crossing.
Right. I don't even like it when you say the best chance of making the crossing, as if you might fail. It doesn't bear thinking about, really. Will you be, is this like one, will you have one sort of a tandem times two then, or four separate craft? Because of course, when you were rowing, you were all taking turns, weren't you, in the same vessel?
Yes, this time it would all be separate crafts. It's kind of going to look like, you know, rubber ducks, I guess, going across.
Yeah.
yeah, we're going to have our own water bike and try and keep as close together as sort of possible, so we don't stray off and keep at the same pace.
Yeah.
So it makes it a lot easier to manage should the emergency happen and the support vessel needs to get involved, or we need to call the Coast Guard.
And Ben, talking of going off course, can you steer? Can you know where you're going and adjust and go in a straight line?
So from what we understand, you have these kind of micro adjustments that you can make on the bike. So you can really kind of adjust your bearing as such, but there's so many variables when it comes to seas, that things like currents and the wind and the waves, so they may end up pushing us off course. So we always need to make sure we take account of things like tide to actually utilize these variables to help us make the crossing. Because there's no way that we can fight against these extreme forces of nature.
Indeed. So when you're coming from the Orkney Islands to the mainland, I suppose if you're a bit off course, it doesn't matter because you're still bound to get to the mainland, are you? Is that also more of a problem on the last leg when you're going from the mainland to the Scilly Isles? Perish the thought, could you miss them altogether?
Yeah, there are instances. So the tidal stream that goes through Orkney Islands and John O'Groats mainland Scotland, there's a tidal stream that goes through. It's one of the most powerful in the world. And if you get that wrong, you're out into the North Sea. So it's all about choosing the right conditions and going at the right time for that. And then you've got five conflicting currents and tidal streams down where the Scilly Isles are, sort of that area, between, you know, mainland England and the Isles of Scilly, and that needs to be taken far more seriously. There's currents that could maybe pull you a little bit too out towards the Atlantic. We'll be doing a second Atlantic crossing, maybe. we do have to be. We've got chart plotting and GPS, making sure we're taking the right current streams.
We must name check the other two guys who are doing this, and I've got plenty more to ask you, so we'll do that in a moment when we pause for a song. Here comes Delamitri, and always the last to know. I've heard about taking exercise during lockdown, but this is ridiculous. BBC Radio Berkshire.
Looks like I am the light.
BBC Radio Berkshire, Delamitri, and always the last to know. We are sitting back and gasping in awe of Isaac Kenyon and Ben Ajayi-Obi and two of their friends at the moment, because they're going to cycle from the Orkneys to the Scillies via mainland UK. And when we say cycle, we mean the sea bits as well. And I keep saying we must name check the others. So, Ben, who are your two fellow lunatics?
So, the two other guys who are going to be joining Isaac and I are Alex, who is a friend of both Isaac and mine from university.
Right.
Who is just a very, very strong-willed person, and we have the utmost confidence that he's going to be a huge asset on this cycle with us. Uh-huh. And also Lucas, who was actually a fellow rower who rowed across the Atlantic during the same time period that myself and Isaac did. However, he actually did it in a solo boat. So it was a whole other dynamic that he was dealing with.
So they've really selected themselves then. I mean, what one has got the most towering achievement imaginable, and the other you know inside out. So you're bound to work together as a great team of four. Isaac, we haven't yet said also why you're doing this, apart from because it's there, the old mountain cliche. There's another really altruistic reason, isn't there?
Yes, there is. At the moment, we're kind of in a world where sort of slowly but surely the nature and green spaces are being taken by urbanisation. And one of the things that we're starting to realise, especially during this pandemic, is how important these green spaces are for the environment, biodiversity, but also for our own physical and mental health. Like we during this pandemic, we realised how important they are to get escape from the house and things like that. Mm. And we'd like to just, you know, bring to the forefront that we need to kind of protect all of these areas and maybe respect them a bit better. You know, take your rubbish away and just maybe not build on these green spaces if you don't have to, if you can go somewhere else. Just try and preserve them, because once they're gone, they're gone.
So you're supporting the National Park UK Foundation Protectors Fund,
yes,
which is a new one,
yes,
on
it's a new charity, actually. It's combining the 15 National Parks charities that originally were all kind of separate, and now going to be combined for the first time with this charity. So if you, whilst we're going to be raising money for that main charity, it will support all of those national parks across the country.
And it says in the press release to regenerate green spaces and protect mental health. So you're protecting the mental health also by supporting this cause, or you have another cause in mind as well that deals specifically with that issue?
They're both intrinsically linked. So by protecting the green spaces and making sure that they're not being built on and they're available and accessible, mm-hmm, for people to go in, it allows people to improve their mental health as well, because it's been proven that outdoors activity and going and exercise in the outdoors is very good for mental health. So it's intrinsically linked. It's a double win, really.
Absolutely. Ben, tell me about the training schedule for this feat.
So the training has been one of the harder parts of this challenge, actually, as you can imagine, since the pandemic hit. Beforehand, we were going on lots of training sessions together, hitting 100-mile weekends, trying to get that kind of consistency and conditioning in our bodies. However, now it's much more of a solo activity, and a couple of the team have invested in things like turbo trainers so they can continue their training indoors.
What is one of those like?
So a turbo trainer is a device that connects onto the back end of a regular, normal push bike. And you can effectively sit on your bike and pedal in a stationary way. So it turns your regular bike into a stationary bike.
Oh, brilliant!
Which is super useful for times like this in the pandemic.
Yeah, very, very good. And you just sort of keep tabs on each other and ask how you're getting on. I mean, do you check stats and things to make sure everybody's keeping up and that sort of thing?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, between the four of us, you know, sometimes when you're training individually, it can get a bit competitive. So sometimes we'll be checking each other's travel stats or other devices we use, like Commute. And keeping track. I think at one point we actually devised, Isaac organized a challenge where we would cycle the equivalent of Land's End to Jono Groats virtually over a set time period, and we turned it into a bit of a competition.
Yeah, no, that's healthy competition though, isn't it, in every sense of the word?
Absolutely.
I quite understand that. Yeah. And how big is the support team that you'll be taking with you?
So we have a variety of teams. We have a crew who are coming along with us to film, because we want to actually turn this adventure into a film production to kind of display the national parks that we travel through as we cycle. You also have a variety of different friends who have agreed to come and join us for certain legs of the journey as well.
Sorry, you're still there, Ben?
Oh, hello, yeah.
We lost you for a moment in the middle of an answer there. You were telling me that you're filming it and you're going to highlight all the national parks that you're going through. But are you taking the same crew right from start to finish? Are they as committed to the project as you are?
Oh, sorry. So there's going to be a film crew who will travel with us the entire journey. But there is also going to be like a group of different people we've contacted who are going to join us for maybe one leg or one or 2 days throughout the journey as well.
Very good. So finally then, if we'd like to help you financially or if we'd just like to keep tabs, what's the best place to do that?
Yes, so the best place to do that is to go onto our website. It's blokesonspokes.co.uk.
Good name, blokesonspokes.co.uk.
Yeah, we love a good pun.
No one's going to forget that.
And also, you can find us on any social media, whichever one you use, also under the name Blokes on Spokes.
All right, and when is it? Because we must speak just before or certainly just after. What's the timescale finally?
So the challenge itself, we're hoping, fingers crossed, it will be in mid-June of this year.
Right.
Pandemic willing. And the timescale is roughly around 14 days.
All right, we'll talk again round about then. Thank you so much both in the meantime. That's Isaac Kenyon and Benjamin Ajayi-Obi, half of Blokes on Spokes. We wish them well. Here's Taylor Swift to take us to the...